Hello everyone, thank you for joining us for what I hope will be a very interesting discussion around some of the latest data in rheumatology. My name is Professor Peter Nash from the School of Medicine, Griffith University in beautiful downtown Brisbane. And today I'm very fortunate to be joined by Frank Verhoeven, who's an assistant professor in rheumatology at the CHU at Besancon in France. Thank you so much for joining us today, Frank. We're talking about your recent paper that was published in Clinical Rheumatology about the effects of DMARDs on sacroiliac joint MRI scores in axial spondyloarthropathy, and it's a systematic review and meta-analysis. And it's really a very interesting and important question. For a long time, we've been trying to show that biologics can prevent X-ray progression in axial spondyloarthropathy. And you've had a very good look at the data and a number of trials. So let's just start. Would you mind just introducing yourself and tell us a little bit about you and where you work and what your interests are?
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Frank Verhoeven, and I'm a young French rheumatologist. And I'm working in Besançon. It's a small small city in France, and I'm very interested in the management of spondyloarthritis, even axial or peripheral with a PSA.
Excellent. So this particular study is a meta-analysis. You looked at over 18 different trials altogether. Can you tell us a little bit about what you were trying to achieve? What was the goal of this particular study?
The goal of the study was to see if different treatments were effective on the same at the same effect, because some big pharma told us to discuss with us about their molecule that they are very effective on the spark score. So I in the our department we think that it will be useful to look with the meta-analysis if the different treatments were as effective on the MRI spark score. That's why we performed this study.
So tell us first, for those who aren't familiar with the SPARC score, what is the SPARC score and why you chose it and not, for example, the Berlin score or other scores that you could have used?
Good question. SPARC score is a score that measures the inflammation on the sacroiliac. And why we choose SPARC score rather than the Berlin, it's just because the SPARC score is the most widely used in the controlled studies that we selected. So that's why we choose this element, this score. With Berlin score, we found only one controlled study evaluated the secukinumab.
And how do you measure a SPARC score?
Could you?
How is it measured? How is it done?
I don't know if it was a centralized for the SPARC score in the studies.
So how did you choose the different studies? How did you select which ones to look at?
I would like control studies, because it's the gold standard to show the efficacy of a treatment on one element. So we would like to have the more robust data. So we chose to select only controlled studies.
Okay, and which drugs in particular did you analyze?
So we look for the drugs indicated in axial SPA, so anti-TNF, anti-IL-17, 17 and JAK inhibitors, even if they are not available for the moment, like filgotinib.
And you used the ACES criteria to diagnose AxSpA, and you extracted all this data, and you started off with something like 700 studies and 721, and you boiled it down to how many articles? Down to about 18 articles for meta-analysis. So what, tell us a little bit about that methodology.
We selected a lot of articles, and we read all the abstracts, and if they didn't meet the inclusion criteria, it was ejected. It was a little bit long, but it is a meta-analysis like the others.
Okay. And the inclusion had to be controlled studies, SPARC score, anything else that was the inclusion criteria?
It was essentially a controlled study with evaluating the SPARC score with the MRI. And it's not so, it's not always available on in every study.
Right. And what time point did you pick? Was it the primary endpoint of the study itself, or was it over the long-term follow-up? When you've got a couple of time points that you picked.
So we chose two time points. First at 3 months, because it is the most used time point. And the second one, if it is available long-term after 1 year. And we decided to use this method because one previous meta-analysis included several studies with different end time for endpoints. So to be comparable.
So, yeah. You looked at 9 studies. You had almost 1,200 patients at week 12 to 16. You looked at a number of different biologics, and you ended up with 4 studies of 600 patients that you had data out to a year. So, tell us a little bit about what were your findings. What were the results of what you looked at? You're comparing TNFs, 17s, and JAKs.
So for the first time point, after 3 months, we showed that all the treatments were effective to decrease the SPARC score, and there's no differences between the three mechanisms of action. And finally, the second time point, which is maybe the most interesting. We showed that there's a two group, a first group with the long-term follow-up with the treatment, and the second group as the control group, who begin the effective treatment after 12 weeks. And we showed that people who start later, 3 months later, the treatment have a less decrease of the SPARC score compared to the long-term follow-up treatment. So we suggest, but we can't be sure, that there is maybe an window of opportunity to decrease the SPARC score at the sacroiliac joint.
And so just explain that a little bit. If you reduce SPARC score significantly, will that stop? Is that a measure of preventing X-ray progression, or will it just improve symptoms?
It's difficult to understand. The results at 1 year show difference but not significant for anti-TNF, with the only difference is the delay for the starting the treatment. So I'm not sure that it changed something for the symptoms of the patients.
Okay, but what about, it's been very difficult to show that TNFs stop X-ray progression. Why do you think that is? Why has there been so much trouble in stopping X-ray progression with biologics that are very effective for symptoms, for reducing spark score? Can we stop the progression radiologically?
I'm not sure. I can't answer to this question with the present work because we don't have the data on X-ray. So I can't say we're effective. I think if we stop the inflammation on the sacroiliac joint, maybe later, 2 years, even 5 years later, there will be a difference. But at 1 year, it's too short to show a difference. And it is maybe the problem with the recent study SURPASS, who did not show any differences between anti-TNF and anti-IL-17.
And is there any predictors that you can think of that will help us to pick people whose spark score will improve the best? Younger people, male or female, treat earlier rather than later. Are there any predictors that you can tell us?
In the present work, we suggest the delay of the beginning of the treatment, but other authors show that more important the spark score was, more effective the treatment will be.
You mean the higher the spark score, the more effective the treatment will be?
Yeah.
Any other elements? So treat early, treat especially the people with a high score. Any other clues from this study, from the results of this study, to help us? Because it's surprising that the JAKs, for example, were not different in efficacy compared to the 17s or the TNFs. Can the JAKs stop X-ray progression?
For the JAKs are very effective on inflammation and spark score. Look for the inflammation on the bone. So I think it's I'm not very surprised between the lack of differences between the treatment, because it's not, it's just an element on MRI and not on a real structural damage. So it's not the same that we look for.
Okay. But it is an interesting question. Does these changes also improve symptoms and progression? So do you plan to do more studies in this direction? What's the next study for you?
For this study, I think it could be interesting to repeat it, but with more patients, with a longer follow-up, and I think 5 years would be the goal, but I don't think that we will have a study during five years. I think nobody will try it.
And is there any way with the data that you have, you could look at symptoms in these people, BASDIs and ASAS criteria? Do you have that data comparing it with the changes in the spark score?
So in the study, we could not find an association and a correlation between the clinical improvement and the spork improvement. I had to call all the corresponding author and tell us, can you give me the data of your patient? So in the way to show this correlation.
So it was nice that you got good improvement by 12 weeks, because in many countries like ours, we have to have achieved a very good response by 12 weeks for the government to continue reimbursing treatment. But as you say, it's the long-term data that's most interesting, and whether you see maintenance of effect or drop off of effect over time. And I think it's the long-term control of inflammation that's going to be most important. Anything else you'd like to take home a message from this study to the clinician about the delay, about the different classes of medication? What's the take home message?
For my opinion, the main two take home message about our study was, first, the efficacy on the spark score of the sacroiliac joint is not an argument to be taken into account when you choose the DMARDs, because all the treatments are effective at 3 months. But when a DMARD is indicated, the B DMARD should be started rapidly, because there is maybe an opportunity. Window of opportunity. This raised the question of early identification of axial SPA, which is currently a major challenge. And the sooner we identify them, the sooner we can treat them, and the more effective the treatment will be in long term.
So that's a very interesting and important finding, that there might be a window of opportunity to treat early, like they have shown in psoriatic arthritis and like they've shown in rheumatoid arthritis. So thank you very much. Any other comments you would like to make? And what do you plan to do after this study? Are you going to keep looking at this particular problem?
For the future, I've got a lot of ideas, but not directly in a relation with this work, because I had a question and we answered to the question with this study. This was is there a difference between the treatment on the spark, and we showed that not clearly, and the opportunity window, it's very difficult to show it. So maybe I will try to show, to make maybe the same study, but on a cohort like DESIR cohort in France. It will be a study in the future.
Yes, because you need bigger numbers and follow for longer, don't you? So in conclusion, TNF inhibitors, IL-17 inhibitors and JAK inhibitors were just as effective in reducing the spark score in active axSpA at 3 months. And at 1 year, you showed a potential opportunity window. And it'd be nice for you to explore in the future whether reducing MRI inflammation correlates with clinical remission and correlates with prevention of damage over time. Thank you so much for your very interesting paper. If you'd like to know more about this paper and others uploaded to the Immune-Mediated Inflammatory Disease Forum website, you can get detailed slide sets are available in the publication section, imidforum.com. Please subscribe to this podcast on Spotify, iTunes, or other podcast media and let us know what you think. You can watch us on the you can watch this on YouTube. You can follow us on Twitter, LinkedIn, or Facebook and keep up with the newest data and the latest information coming in 2024. Thank you so much for your time, Frank. It was greatly appreciated.
Thank you.